It's just me and my trusty tech crew, Stephanie, here this morning as we go through worship. A couple of announcements before we get started. It's Encore Sunday, which brings us into a whole new realm of how do we give? Later today, I will send out, I've been talking with Roger, and I think I understand everything that's available to us as far as how to give online. You can also mail your checks here to the church, and we will get them deposited. So you have plenty of options for giving for Encore Sunday and to keep up on your pledge. I think that that's the announcements that I have for today. So I'm going to go over and start our prelude music, and we'll get our hearts in the right place for worship. Will you join me in our opening prayer? Source of life, God of great mercy and love, we come to you this day seeking restoration of our sight. Clear away our blindness and give us new vision of all that we can accomplish in your name. Give us strength and confidence to truly witness to your abiding love and faithfulness, for we offer this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Shadows into your radiance by the blood I likeness, so our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Here, here, may our lives tell the story. Shine on me, shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to hear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. Set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Is good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, my chains are gone. Set free, my God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Thank you.
These words from the 23rd Psalm, it's not the words that you're used to hearing. It's the New International Version, and we usually say the King James Version. I can't hear you, so if you know it by heart and you want to say it in your homes, you're more than welcome to. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of darkness, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The scripture that I speak on this morning is the 9th chapter of John. Yeah, the whole thing. All 41 verses of it. And it reads, as he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Neither this man nor his parents sinned, said Jesus. But it happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. As long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming, when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. After saying this, he spit on the ground, made some mud with the saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. Go, he told him, wash in the pool of Siloam. This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home, seeing. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, isn't this the same man who used to sit begging? Some claimed that he was, others said, no, he only looks like him. How then were your eyes opened? They asked. He replied, The man they call Jesus made some mud and put it on my eyes. He told me to go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed, and then I could see. Where is this man? They asked him. I don't know, he said. The Pharisees came to investigate the healing. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been blind. Now the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was a Sabbath. Therefore, the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. He put mud on my eyes, the man replied, and I washed, and now I see. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But others asked, how can a sinner perform such signs? So they were divided. Then they turned again to the blind man. What have you to say about him? It was your eyes he opened. The man replied, he is a prophet. They still did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they sent for the man's parents. Is this your son? They asked. Is this the one you say was born blind? How is it that now he sees? We know he is our son, the parents replied. And we know he was born blind. But how he can see now, or who opened his eyes, we don't know. Ask him, he's of age. He will speak for himself. His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders who already had decided that anyone who acknowledged that Jesus was the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. That is why his parents said, he is of age, ask him. A second time they summoned the man who had been blind. Give glory to God by telling the truth, they said. We know this man is a sinner. He replied, whether he is a sinner or not, I do not know. One thing I do know, I was blind, but now I see. Then they asked him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered, I've told you already, and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciples too? Then they hurled insults at him and said, you are this fellow's disciple. We are disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses, but as for this fellow, we don't even know where he comes from. The man answered, now that's remarkable. You don't know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners. He listens to the godly person who does his will. Nobody has ever heard of opening the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. To this they replied, you were steeped in sin at birth. How dare you lecture us? And they threw him out. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, and when he found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? Who is he, sir? The man asked. Tell me so that I may believe in him. Jesus said, you have now seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you. Then the man said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Jesus said, for judgment I have come into this world, so that the blind will see, and those who see will become blind. Some Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and asked, what? Are we blind too? Jesus said, if you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But now that you claim you can see, your guilt remains. Spit in mud. It seems so raw and wrong in these days of washing your hands. Moses had his staff to usher in plagues, part the Red Sea, strike a rock and bring forth water, among other miracles. Jesus comes along and uses sometimes a touch. Today, he uses spit and mud and water. Oftentimes, Jesus uses whatever is close by to remind us that healing can come from anything and anyone that is blessed by God to serve as God means of healing. Why did this man require healing to begin with? He was born blind. Too often, we see different abilities as sin. Or different ability. Differently able. Sometimes this shows up as being deaf. Could be somebody with Down syndrome. I think I've given you enough examples that you can continue to think about things that we labeled in our life as a possible sin that caused somebody to have the ailment or different abilities that they do. Like so many others in this story, Cindy and I have looked at each other and asked ourselves if our boy's hearing loss was the result of some sin. It's an anxious time when you discover a child is differently abled. And it opens your mind and journey of faith in ways that are different and difficult to articulate. I wish that all of you had the experiences Cindy and I continue to have with our now adult sons. My boys were loved from the beginning. First, known by God and then hoped for by Cindy and me. They were loved in the anticipation of watching Cindy's belly grow and feeling them move around in their protected place. Loved before we put eyes on them. Loved when we saw them, and that love never died. Even when their behavior was less than what was hoped for. Their different ableness is not from some sin. And Jesus reminds us of that today. We know that their deafness was actually caused by a recessive gene that Cindy and I both carry. The odds were 1 in 25 that she and I would fall in love, get married, have children. No sin, just love. They have brought us to an awareness and a perspective of life that has changed us and shaped us as adults and as a family. Yet I know my journey of faith is unique to me, and what you would get out of the experiences I have had would lead you to a different place than where I am at. The blind man knows without a doubt where his healing comes from. Mud, spit, and water. But most importantly, a man named Jesus caused the man who was once blind to be able to see. He once was blind. Then he could see. I wonder if the man knew what was happening to him. What did he think on the way to the pool to wash? Did he doubt on the way, thinking it was just another hoax, prepared to be disappointed? Did he know in his heart? Was he giddy with excitement, wondering what the world looked like? Was his mind prepared to take in the faces of what his friends looked like? Was he prepared to see what violence looked like when put alongside the sounds he knew? Was he prepared for the reaction of his community and family? I wonder, did he ever wish that he was blind again? We never asked our firstborn about hearing aids. We knew we could hear if he had hearing aids, and as responsible parents who wanted the best for him, we got hearing aids for him. We walked with him through his smiles as a three-year-old when he started to match faces with voices. We held him when loud noise frightened and when it was all too much for his mind. We took the hearing aids off to give his mind a break from all that was new. Our other boy is more profoundly deaf, and he can't speak intelligibly. Where was our miracle of healing? Why can I, as a Christian, read about healings in the Bible and not experience them in my own life? I believe. Jesus says that we have faith, that if we believe that great things can happen, and in his absence, with the presence of the Holy Spirit, even greater things can happen than happen when Jesus. Cochlear implants weren't being done on young children at the time our son was being diagnosed. When they did start being done, we felt the choice needed to be our sons. Many deaf people are proud of how God put them together, and we did not want our son to resent a choice we made for him that he did not make or want for himself. We didn't bring it up, the implants, until he was in his late teens. He chose the procedure with much guidance from physicians who were wise enough to advise him and us about what to expect. Like the blind man in our story, he chose to be healed, knowing all the while his new reality of being able to hear would still be nothing like what it means for you and I to hear. We laughed with him when he realized it makes a sound when you go to the bathroom, and we continue to help him process the sounds he hears even now, 10 years after his implant. We talked about why we didn't have the surgery done earlier in life, and I wouldn't do it any differently. We need to claim our healing, because many times, like the blind man in our story today, we are the only one who is going to accept the healing and how it affects us. The blind man can witness to the actions of Jesus in his life. Our son can also witness to where his healing comes from. Like his baptism, he claims his healing as a choice he made for himself. I use a resource named Feasting on the Word to help me develop my sermons. There were two interesting comments from different people in the commentary. The first one, the light of the world is in our midst and we need not shut our eyes. In fact, the best thing to do is to open our eyes wide. We will not be blinded by the light. We will be saved. And the second one, just because you had a holy moment with mud does not mean the rest of us won't be scraping it off our boots. Did you notice that no one recognized the now sighted man? That has so many perspectives. Does it mean they never really noticed him in his usual place of begging? Does it mean that because he now could see, people truly couldn't recognize him? Does it mean that people never took the time to get beyond his disability and see him as a person? Which perspective do you see the story from? Is it just stuff like mud to be scraped from your shoes because this man, this story is of no concern to you? Or is it a reminder for you of the light of Christ in our world? When something changes, it's natural for us to react in fear. We see this in our world today. Some people are totally resistant to the social distancing thing. Some people still went on spring break and are still going to bars and parties. Others have gone to the other extreme and are not even leaving their homes. Are we even aware of our actions and reactions? We all hold biases because of our experiences in life, and they creep into our life, sometimes without our even realizing it. Something like the Ten Commandments. They are a great set of rules, and many laws are built upon their guidance. But they are Old Testament, Old Covenant, and Jesus made with us a new covenant. Stay with me here, folks. I'll give you a moment to process, because I know I'm touching on some biases you have. I'm going to give you a second just to chill. I'll take a deep breath now. Jesus came to uphold the laws of the Old Testament. Everything in the Old Testament is there to guide us in how God desires us to live life. But Jesus adds to the understanding of the law. And it's our responsibility as followers of Christ to do more than just follow the law, because Jesus made with us a new covenant. Jesus challenges us to move beyond the law. Is this pandemic mud to be scraped from your shoe, or is it the light of Christ to be revealed through our challenges? Why are you reacting the way you are to the place we find ourselves today? What are your experiences that influence your reactions? How can you act and react in ways that reveal the love of God? How can you trust God more in our current reality? The followers of Christ are needed in our world now. We need to let the world know that we have fears too. But we place those fears with Christ, and that changes our perspective and our reaction. Because we trust God, we act in different ways, ways that overcome fear and reveal love. I get anxious like many others. Expressing our anxiety to God and to others brings our anxiety out of the darkness and into the light, where we can find assurance that God walks with us in our reality. Whether you see this as mud to be scraped from your shoes or the light of Christ shining through, God is with us, meeting us in the place where we are at. God reveals our blind spots and opens our eyes to new ways of being the body of Christ, revealing God's love. Amen. Let us be together in prayer. Lord, we thank you for the stories of Scripture that guide and influence us. Especially during these times that we are facing, it's easy for us to snap at our loved ones out of our anxiety. It is sometimes difficult for us to remember your love in everything we do. So we take time to confess these things to you this day. We ask you to take these things that we do, help us to understand them so that they lose their power over us. And so that we can recognize them when we fall into those traps and bad habits. You have given us beautiful creation. We can see the flowers starting to bud, preparing to let go as we move closer to spring. We feel the warm sunshine on us as we work outside, as we sit outside on our decks, soaking it in and getting a little fresh air. We ask you, Lord, to be with those who are in perilous places because of this disease, this virus that we are facing across the world. Be with doctors and nurses, with scientists and first responders. Keep these people safe as they work to keep us safe. We ask you, Lord, to be with friends and family that are on our hearts and in our minds this day, who are facing this time of social distancing alone. And for those who are alone and finding it a time to confront demons. Be with them. Difficult things. Lead us not into places of depression and darkness, but let us be aware of the ways that you are in what we are. May indeed your light shine through us, and may we be the instruments to bring light to other people's lives. We ask you to be with our military people in the places where they serve, to keep them safe as they are away from family. In this time where we have time to contemplate, maybe even get bored, speak to us about how our lives can and maybe even should change to be closer to you. Remind us of the power that there is in taking rest. Reconnect us as communities in new and different ways. And Lord, I am trusting that there are people out there that are joining me in this service. And I give us all time to pause and to pray to you the things that are on our hearts. Take these prayers, Lord. Hold on to them. Give us all hope and strength for the days to come. In your holy name we pray. Amen. I hope that you all have a good day, that you take time today to rest and connect by phone or other means with people in your community and people that are far away, but in your hearts. Blessings to all of you.